MarkAlain, welcome back to the show.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me.
So I'm here with Emma Vigeland. And, you know, the last time we spoke was, well, it was probably in April. A lot of things have transpired since that time. So I want to just start with that. And we should tell people that you had a tremendous amount of experience in Ebola, dealing with Ebola and other, epidemics, pandemics. From where we were, like, I've been trying to rack my brain, like, you know, from where we were in April, where I think our sense was like, you know, people have dropped the ball here. The CDC is sort of like, you know, behind it a little bit. But what has developed since then is this sense that the response has been driven not just by incompetence, but by almost like an ideology. Have you ever come across that? I mean, is that a common response to a pandemic where it's not just incompetence, but it's like, ideologically speaking, you shouldn't take precautions?
Right. Right. You know, I often say the plan of action has been inaction. And that's the only way that you can do it. I mean, you know, the idea of having 50 states account for themselves to address the pandemic, and there's more than 2,500 public health departments or health departments. So you have 50 states, 50 governors doing 50 different things. You have some that have mask mandates, some that don't, some that are in various forms of opening or closing all over the country. You have 2,500 different public health departments or health departments that are all doing things completely different. Something like this is completely unheard of. And the analogy that I use is I was working for the World Health Organization during the Ebola epidemic. And I was very fortunate. I was in Freetown, which is in Sierra Leone, Freetown, which is the capital of Sierra Leone, where I was doing my investigations and looking for cases. And so I was in very high level meetings pretty regularly, government meetings, where they were very much addressing the issue on a regular basis. And the first thing they were addressing was misinformation. That was the first thing they had to fight. Then the second thing we had to fight was then addressing all the issues that has to come with an epidemic like Ebola. To see the complete inert activity, to see the fact that there is an inaction, and I think at sometime in like mid June to late June, I had kind of like probably a mini nervous breakdown, and I'm very open about that because it occurred to me, oh my God, they're not doing anything. You know, the conversation you and I had was very much like, wow, something doesn't seem right. There should be Johnny on. You know, we then later learned that the president knew about this in late January. And to be perfectly honest with you, I think it is somewhat criminal that we are allowing this huge morbidity, and we don't even know what the long-term effects of coronavirus are. Maybe we'll talk about that later. But then the mortality that we're seeing here is, I think, the number three mortality behind something like the Civil War and World War II. And it's just kind of happening without any sort of, right now, I don't even know where the outrage is. They're not allowing a transition to occur. And more people are dying. And you have somebody like Dr. Fauci. You even actually had Biden even say, President-elect Biden say that as we continue to not have access to transition, more and more people are going to die. And it just seems like there just doesn't seem to be any sort of effect as a result of that. And as I was saying, I had a complete epiphany, which resulted in anxiety and somewhat of a nervous breakdown when it occurred to me that we're not doing anything about it. And right now we have the highest rates of cases in the world. We have the highest rates of mortality in the world. And right now, North Dakota has the highest mortality rate. If North Dakota were considered a country, it has the highest mortality rate than any other part of the world. And that's largely due to the fact that there's been inaction.
When we spoke back in April, you had told me that the history of pandemics is such that the second peak comes approximately six months after the first one and tends to be worse. And sadly, it appears that you were correct. We have improved, I think, we have improved the mortality rate as a function of therapies. And I think of realizing who is at most risk and being quite clear in that. But the bottom line is we are now, I'm looking at these numbers, and just in the past 14 days, we are up 40% in terms of the number of deaths. And we are up 50% in the number of hospitalized. We are up 79% in the number of cases. And cases is a leading indicator for those other two issues. So there's every reason to believe 14 days from now, we may be up closer to 50 or 60% on deaths and even higher on hospitalizations, if I understand how this works now. So let me ask you this from April. What has surprised you about coronavirus itself, if anything has? Like, what have we learned? I mean, at that time, we were just learning that, I think, if I remember correctly, you were saying, look, you got to keep washing hands, et cetera, but it was just on the cusp of understanding that these things get aerosolized and that air, the communication via air is even more, prevalent than had been assumed at first.
Absolutely. In fact, I went back and listened. And so a couple things. One is I was criticized for speculating that it may be aerosolized. We now know it's aerosolized. So, and then I don't know if you remember, I was saying, I think we're probably less than a week away from having some mask mandates come down the line. And then that actually happened not too far afterwards. So I'm going to answer your question in two sides. I'll talk about the public health side, and then I'll talk about the virus side, the effects of the virus. The public health side, what has surprised me the most is that this virus is obviously it's a respiratory virus. The idea of touch and whatever, I'm an infectious diseases doctor. Of course, I want everybody to wash their hands regularly, right? So I like that everybody's been washing their hands. And I've been, the idea of not being able to shake hands anymore is great. I love the elbow bump, love the fist bump. Okay, great. So, but it's overwhelmingly a respiratory virus. There's no question about it. What has surprised me the most though was, and what we didn't know at the time, and most people say that it was an error, and I don't think so at all. When we talk about the masking, at first there was this mixed messaging of masking. There was no mixed messaging of masking. Yes, there was to a certain degree not the idea of not using masks that doctors and nurses needed in the hospital. So you could use any sort of cloth mask, to do that. It was the idea that asymptomatic transmission, we had no idea that 40% of asymptomatic transmission occurred. And once it became clear to us that there was such a high level of asymptomatic transmission, that's when we started hitting the mask big time, right? So at first we thought it was just like SARS, the SARS-CoV-1 virus, the SARS epidemic, or a lot of other viruses that you are most infectious when you are feeling symptomatic. And so we knew that if you were sick with the coronavirus, you would stay home, you wouldn't be transmitting virus. The big shocking thing to me was the fact that it can be asymptomatically transmitted, hence the importance of masks and mask mandates. There's no question about that. And now finally, the CDC has finally gotten around to recognizing, and this is something that we've known a long time as well, that masks not only, so my mask protects you, but then my mask also protects me as well. And I wish that had been the messaging from the get-go, because I think that we probably have more of a buy-in for masking now.
Even if it's not an N95 mask, it cuts down transmission, even if it's just simply like a t-shirt mask or something.
Absolutely.
Like that.
Any sort of cloth mask, anything, mask like this, for example, which is what I wear when I'm outside. And then I wear like a KN95 or a surgical mask when I'm indoors with other people. The second thing that has surprised me the most, and this is the thing that's probably the most important, is that we don't know what the long-term effects of this virus are. We recognize that the virus over a period of time, even if it's asymptomatic, can have pulmonary scarring in your lungs. It can have inflammation of the heart, causing a condition called cardiomyopathy, which is inflammation of the heart, which can cause scarring of the heart as well. And then just recently, of course, we have all the central nervous system issues, the brain fog people talk about, the anxiety, the depression that comes after infection. But then also recently we've noticed that that it may also be a cause for infertility in men. And there has been evidence that has shown that there has been virus has been found in testicles and has been the a cause of infertility, at least for one person in this one paper that had been published. So we don't know what these long-term effects are. And when I speculate outward 2 or 3 years, as we start to be able to look in the rearview mirror and see all of the long-term effects, I think there's going to be a national reckoning. I think there's going to be a lot of anger and there's going to be a lot of frustration when people realize, especially as, you know, when we do the epidemiological studies to show, had we done this then, we could have eliminated all of this mortality or all this morbidity. When people right. realize that, that may be a thing, I think that there's going to be a lot of frustration as to how we handled the coronavirus epidemic.
Is there a connection to viral load and having some of
100%
these intense effects? So the bigger the viral load, some of the consequences you're talking about are more likely?
Absolutely. We see it with HIV. For example, people who inject drugs get a much higher viral load of HIV versus when transmitted through through sex. And those folks that get that much higher viral load, like let's say that are intravenous drug users, they die much quicker of AIDS. They progress to AIDS much faster and they die. We see it with Ebola, that was without question. And then now we're seeing it here that very likely that those with higher viral loads have more severe symptoms and also have more likely to die as well. Hence, the wearing of the mask is so important because let's say you are exposed to the coronavirus, just even the wearing of the mask may significantly reduce that viral load. And a great one of my colleagues from UCSF, Monica Gandhi, wrote a really fascinating paper about this in the New England Journal, where she likened it to variolation or inoculation, which is what we used to do way back in the days when we used to vaccinate for smallpox. We would take a little bit of smallpox from one person, give it to somebody else. That was called inoculation. And you just give a little bit, and then it protects against smallpox. What we're seeing here is that, and she speculates, and it's a really fascinating theory, that just wearing of the mask may just give somebody just a little bit of virus, and that may account for why we're seeing so many asymptomatic cases.